In the last video, we looked at what HTML, CSS, and JavaScript is, and how the browser uses that to render and display a web page. In this video, we will now talk about how the HTML code gets to your browser in the first place. So we will learn about the URLs and the HTTP protocol. Let's start by running a simple web server on our local machine. Depending on what kind of language you want to use for development, there are different options for running a production or development server. For example, if you want to write PHP code, there are projects like XAMPP that sets up an Apache with a database and PHP enabled for development purposes. Or if you want to write a Python web app in Flask, it will come with its built-in debug web server. But let's start. Last video, we wrote a very simple HTML page and opened it in the browser from our local file system. Now let's try to surf this HTML page via HTTP from a web server instead. Recent versions of PHP as well as Python have cool features to run a simple HTTP server. So a server is just a program that gives you a file if you ask for them. Let's start a simple server with PHP. If you don't have PHP installed yet, install it with apt-get install php5 CLI on Ubuntu or whatever matches your operating system. Then write php minus capital S followed by an IP address and a port where to listen from. In this case, we only want to listen on 127.0.0.1, which is a special IP referencing localhost, meaning this IP points at your own computer, and then port 8080. Port 80 is the default port for websites because people on the internet agreed on that, but generally you can run a server on any port you like. A port is just a number inside of a TCP packet. So when the network card and your operating system receives a TCP packet, meaning it's just a bunch of bytes, it will look at the port number inside that packet. And then it will check in a table if a program is listening, meaning if it's waiting for a packet on that particular port. Then the operating system will give the content of that packet to that program. And we registered PHP to listen on port 8080. So now let's open this in the browser. We want to load a site via HTTP, whatever that means. Then the IP address, which is localhost, and pointing to this local machine and the port 8080. Not found. The requested resource slash is not found. Let's look at the terminal. We can see here that on that day, this IP address tried to access slash, but there is no such file. When we start the server, it displayed to us that the document root is here. And we know we have the test.html file in here. So let's try to access test.html. Cool, that worked. And in the terminal, we can see that this IP performed another request, this time to test.html. We can also see that we apparently tried to access favicon.io. We didn't type that in the browser. Well, see those tiny icons for websites you visit? Well, those are favicons, and people on the internet agreed that file is supposed to be called favicon.io by default. So the browser is checking if you have such a file so that it can display a neat icon for you. Now let's open the browser developer tools again and go to the network tab. Then we reload this page. Here you can see now all the requests the browser is doing to display this page. In this case, it's just two simple requests to test.html and the image. But if you do the same, for example, on Reddit, this is going nuts. It's loading so many resources. So let's look at that test.html request. So first of all, it accessed the file with the name test.html. And the status return code was 200. This means everything went fine. For example, earlier we saw the error status code 404, which stands for not found. There's a huge list on what certain status code numbers mean. Now let's click on it. Let's first check the response tab. This is what the server returned to us after we asked if we can get the file test.html. That's just the content of the file we requested. But how did we actually ask the server to give us test.html? let's do an HTTP request by hand. We use a simple tool called Netcat for that. Netcat is a simple Unix utility which reads and writes data across network connections using TCP or UDP. But why would that help us with the HTTP protocol? Well, HTTP is built on top of TCP. The TCP layer is responsible for the ports, and TCP sits on top of the IP layer, which handles the IP addresses. IP addresses identify the receiving computer in a network, and the ports are used by the operating system to decide to which application it should forward the content of the packet. So the web server will handle the content of that packet. And the content will follow a special format, which is HTTP. So this means we can use Netcat to send a TCP packet to the web server with any payload we want, and we can decide that we want to talk HTTP. Now let's request the test.html page. First we open a connection to the IP and port, and when we type something, that text will be sent as a TCP payload to the web server. To request test.html, we have to do the following. We start with the HTTP method get, so we tell the server that we want to get a resource, followed by a space and then the resource path, in this case /test.html. Now, some web servers want to follow the HTTP protocol more strictly, but in this case, this is already enough. To finish up this request, we have to indicate that with an empty line, and we get immediately a response back from the server. So it responded to us with code 200, everything is okay. And there are some key value pairs called HTTP headers, for example, informing us that the request resource has the content type text.html and how long the content will be, followed by an empty line and the content of the resource. Now, if we were a browser, we would read that content type and we would know we have HTML, and then take the file content and render that in a window. So HTTP is literally just human readable plain text that is sent between your browser and the web server. And yes, that makes it super inefficient. Why not use binary? But that makes it super easy for us to understand. Now, let's go back to the developer console and check the first tab of the request, the headers. Here you can see the response headers from the server again, those key value pairs before the content of the file. But you can also see request headers. So the browser also added some key value pairs to the HTTP request, and did not only send this one line we did. We can also see this if we quit our web server and use Netcat instead to listen on that port, so we can see the content of the TCP packet. And now when we refresh the page, the browser will send the HTTP request again to this IP and port, but this time Netcat will display us what was received. We just want to see a full proper HTTP request from the browser. And here it is. You can see it's a bit longer than what we sent the first time. For example, it sent a user agent with Chrome. So the web server knows that web browser Chrome is requesting the file and can act accordingly. For example, if the user agent were phone, it might want to send a special mobile version of the file instead. It also sent an accept header telling the web server what kind of content types it can work with or what language the user prefers. Oh, and with Netcat we can also send back a response, so we can just send here some text not including any HTTP header, the browser will make sense of it. So HTTP is super easy, right? A browser simply creates a connection to a server, which is another program that has the purpose of providing files when requested, and the browser can ask for files or resources by using this plain text human readable HTTP format, and the server will respond with the content of the requested file. In the next video, we will write a little bit of shitty PHP code, which can be used to dynamically create files that are returned by the web server instead of only serving static files from the file system. And after we got that knowledge, we can then soon head slowly into security-related topics.